Good afternoon. Welcome to our continued series of Lent and our weekly services on Wednesday afternoons. So this week and then next Wednesday will be the last two of the weekly Lenten services. And then on the week of Holy Week, on Good Friday, we'll have a service at 2 o'clock as well, and that will be the Stations of the Cross. So welcome to as we worship together today, and let's pray. Lord Jesus, we pray that you would draw us closer to your love and grace, and may the fruit of your Holy Spirit be manifest in our lives. Glory and honor and praise to your holy name. Amen. Let's sing a couple songs as we begin, and the first one is page 56, Beneath the Cross of Jesus, page 56. Beneath the Cross of Jesus, page 56.
Beneath the cross of Jesus, I fain would take my stand.
Shelter from the stormy
So over here on my left, your right, is my wonderful daughter, Janetta, my youngest daughter. And she's a senior in high school. She's not able to, so we have these community Lenten services here at the nursing home and then in the evening at various churches. And tonight, the host church will be Our Savior's Lutheran. And tonight is also the night of a section championship or subsection championship basketball game. And Janetta will be attending that as well as many other people from across our community.
I can tell that's your daughter because she resembles your
daughter. Okay. So she came this afternoon, since she won't go. So she's came to support Dad today, so I'm appreciating that. So here in Northwest Minnesota, there is a common practice when it comes to hospitality. Let's say you're a guest at someone's home. Maybe you've just been over for coffee and dessert, or maybe it's been a meal followed by the dessert, and the dessert was cake. Let's say cake or pie, whatever it was. And before you leave, the host says to you, how about, let me get it up here. How about a piece for the road? Does that sound familiar? And you say, no, that's okay. I'll be fine. You sure? There's a lot of cake left over here. Well, you know, that one piece filled me up, and I wouldn't want to short you. Well, I can't eat all this leftover cake. Besides, this one has your name on it. Well, okay. I guess another piece will be good with coffee tomorrow. And so the host dishes up a very large, generous piece of cake and puts it into an empty cooler bowl. And you get up and you go and stand by the door for another 10 minutes as you're saying goodbye. And you visit a little bit longer. And then you head out to the car and stand by the car for another 10, 15 minutes visiting. And finally get into the car and roll down the window and visit a little bit more with the host and hostess. And finally you say, you know, I just got to get going. Thanks again for the meal. And you hold up the cool bowl and thanks for the peace for the road. Well, today for my message, I've changed the peace for the road slightly to a peace for the road. Instead of being spelled P-I-E-C-E, a peace for the road, spelled P-E-A-C-E. For our Lenten services this year, our theme has been the fruit of the Spirit, which comes from the verses in Galatians 5, verses 22 to 23, where the Bible says, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. And over the course of these Lenten series, we have been focusing on different ones of those fruit. There's 9 of them mentioned, but in these series of 5, we're only getting 5 of them. Started off the series with Pastor Amber Kalina from Our Savior speaking on the subject of goodness or being gracious or generous. And then the week after that, Pastor James Crandall spoke on faithfulness. And then last week, Pastor Ryan Sarempa spoke on the subject of love. Today, the subject is peace. P-E-A-C-E. The other day, I did a quick search online of the word peace. You type it in on Google. And guess how many results came up in just a quick search? Any ideas? Almost 4.5 million. Now, I only got through about 3 million of them when I'm reading them. No, I didn't even read any. But obviously, there was a very large amount of results. And it could, obviously, it's a very popular subject, the word peace. We long for peace. We search for peace. Our hearts ache for peace. in a world torn by so much conflict, and many are just trying to find some kind of peace. Now, we often associate peace with tranquil, quiet settings, maybe along a lake, maybe your favorite place, a lake that you've gone to, maybe you've had a family, have had cabin at, maybe it's been up at Lake of the Woods, along the in the Angle Inlet area, or maybe along Lake of the Woods in Rainy River area, or maybe it's Maple Lake, or Cass Lake, or Lake Bemidji, or someplace down by Detroit Lakes. This picture that's up here on the screen is from Yellowstone Lake, out in Yellowstone National Park. This past summer we were out there, and had been there through the day, and on our way out, we went by Yellowstone Lake, and it was just the right time of the day. The colors and the you can see the lake was just so peaceful and tranquil, and it was just that perfect time of the day. Here's another one. Anybody recognize where this one is at? It's nearby, Old Mill State Park, and we happened to be there on a very beautiful September day a few years ago, and it was just a perfect, nice, warm, late summer afternoon. And so those type of settings, you know, that we think of as peaceful. What are some other settings that you may associate with a peaceful, quiet setting? Any thoughts? Where might you tend to associate a peaceful setting?
Backyard of your house.
Maybe for some it was on the porch, maybe with a cup of coffee in hand. Maybe for some that peaceful setting is out in the deer stand, or in the man cave, or out in the backyard, in the shop, in the wood shop. Whatever that happy place is, maybe it's out in the garden, wherever, and those places where you just go, and it's just this nice setting.
Lake Bronson.
But what about when the lake is raging and then the storm has come up and the weather has changed? And because we all know that those pleasant, tranquil settings aren't always pleasant and tranquil. We know that the storms come up, or the instead of a quiet porch, it's a chaotic house. Is peace possible then? Or those seasons in life when that changed and we're no longer able to go to those happy places that we used to go to, aren't able to be out in the yard, aren't able to be in the deer stand, aren't able to be in the wood shop, whatever it may be, because life has changed. Can we still experience peace then? What about in the aftermath of a storm? We've all seen images on TV of the path of destruction left by tornadoes and path of destruction left by hurricanes. Can people still experience peace at that time? Or how about in the intensive care unit at the hospital? Some of you have been there. Some of you have been there as a patient. Some of you have been there as a family member, a loved one of someone who was in ICU, and you've spent some long and weary nights and days in the waiting room, back and forth from the waiting room to the room. Where is peace then? What about at a funeral? That loved one is gone. Or at the graveside, and taps is being played. Or even after the funeral is over, and the friends and loved ones are no longer there, and yet there's still those times of grief. Is peace possible then? Today the subject is a peace for the road. And there are two primary categories of peace. One is that the peace that comes from the environment, the surroundings that we're in, that peaceful spot, that happy place, that along the lake, or wherever it may be. It's those places where there's an absence of conflict. But then those types of peace we know don't always last, because things change. The second category of peace is the peace that comes from God. And that's what I want to focus on for just the next few minutes. There are two primary biblical words for peace. One found in the Old Testament and one found in the New Testament. The one in the Old Testament, the Hebrew word, you probably are very familiar with. The word shalom. Has anybody heard that? The word shalom means peace. And the New Testament word, which was translated from Greek, is one that probably doesn't roll off our tongues as easily, but it's irene. Or does anybody here, either your middle name or somebody in your family or your first name, is Irene? Anybody have a family member with the name Irene? Well, Irene means peace. And these words, both shalom and irene, convey the idea of contentment and soundness and wholeness and completeness and well-being. Shalom is a common greeting among Jewish people when they greet, or when they say hello, or when they say farewell, when they say hello, it's shalom. When they say goodbye, shalom, wanting this extending of peace. And in the Bible, the word shalom in the Old Testament is used around 250 times, and in the New Testament, the word for peace is over 90 times. So it's a common theme in the Bible. One of those references in the New Testament comes from John chapter 14. Verse 26 and 27 says, "But the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and remind you of everything I have told you." And then John 14, verse 27, Jesus says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Don't let your heart be troubled or fearful." Now, it is significant for us to know when Jesus shared this word about peace. It was at the time, it was the night leading up to his arrest and his crucifixion. And in the chapters of 13 through 17 of the Gospel of John, Jesus shares several things with his disciples, several important instructions and words of encouragement, including this one that you see on the screen from John 14, verse 27. Knowing that troubled times were ahead, Jesus says, "My peace I leave with you." Jesus knew that troubled times were ahead for him, and he knew that troubled times were ahead for his disciples. "Peace I leave with you," Jesus says. "My peace I give you. Don't let your hearts be troubled or fearful." And then that same night, Jesus goes on to say this about peace. John 16, verse 33, "I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. You will have suffering in this world. Be courageous. I have conquered the world." These verses in John 14 and John 16 really highlight peace for the road, peace for the journey that we face, the reality that is possible of being able to experience and live in his peace. You know, we've all experienced brokenness, we've all experienced health issues, we've experienced loss, we've experienced trials. As believers, followers of Jesus, we are not immune to troubles. We live in a broken world. Troubles and trials in life are real. They come with the journey. But here's the good news. Peace that comes from Jesus Christ is also real. Yes, trials and troubles in life are real, but God's peace through Christ is also real. And my prayer today is for all of us to truly know the peace that comes from Jesus Christ. And the starting point for us to experience that peace is by first opening our hearts to Jesus Christ. When we know Christ, the fruit of the Spirit is able to grow in our lives. And the opposite is also true. If we don't know Christ as Savior, we're not going to be able to experience the depth of His peace. Today, you may be living with pain and loss, and sorrow and grief, suffering, persecution, separation, loneliness, just so many different things that we face. But in these very moments, it's the promise of Christ's peace that's more than just a good sounding idea. May the reality of His peace fill our souls. Real, genuine. So when these ties of trial come, or these seasons in life have come our way that are challenging, let's choose to take His peace with us. How do we do that? How do we experience peace on this journey of life? Here's just a few things. One, we need to stay connected in our relationship with Christ. Also in that passage where Jesus told His disciples on that night, chapters 13 to 17, is included this verse, John 15, verse 5. Yes, I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Staying in the vine, abiding in the vine, remaining in Christ, and fruit comes, including peace. So staying connected to Jesus is one of those ways that we can have peace for the road. Another way is to just to really believe and hold on to God's promises. And where we can just say, God, Jesus, you know, I have you in my life. Your presence is inside of me. And you have promised your peace. And in this situation that I'm facing, I'm not going to allow my heart to be overcome with fear. Today, I choose to live in your peace. And another way of holding on to the promises would be found, like, say, in Psalm 4, verse 8, where, you know, in those times in our life when we're at night, sometimes we're awake, we're troubled, we can't sleep, and there's just these things turning over and over in our minds. Here's a verse that we can read and memorize and just declare back to the Lord. It says, I will lie down and sleep in peace. For you alone, Lord, make me live in safety. And then one more way that we can have peace for the road is to let the peace of Christ rule in our hearts. It says in Colossians 3, verse 15, let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you are called to peace, and be thankful. We're called to it. It's part of what God has for us is to experience His peace. And this aspect of letting Christ's peace rule in our hearts, it's kind of, think of like an umpire. Anybody ever watch baseball or softball? Some of you do. When a call is made, who has the final say? The umpire. Now the batter can be up there, and the umpire says strike, and the batter says no, it wasn't. Who has the final call? The ump. Or the mom or dad in the stands that says that wasn't a strike. Who has the final call? The ump. And allowing the peace of Christ to rule in our hearts is like letting the ump make the decision. The final say is with the Lord. That with the final say is, you know, so when we don't have a peace about something, we need to pay attention to that. We need to listen to that peace or lack of peace. Maybe you're about ready to say something and just kind of fire something off in a in a response to somebody, you're kind of maybe upset, and you all of a sudden you just realize, no, I shouldn't say that, and you hold your tongue. Or a common way today is maybe you're ready to send off a text message or a email, and you're just all fired up and you're ready to send it, and you just have a sense of like, no, I need to hold back. Listen to that lack of peace. Let the umpire call the shots. Or maybe you're about making a decision, and all of the decision that you're about to make, you've weighed out the pros and the cons, and it seems like a very practical, logical decision, and yet you just don't have a peace about it. Maybe there's nothing immoral or illegal or unethical about the course of action that you're considering, but you just don't have a peace about it. Listen to that. On the other hand, you're maybe making a decision and it just has this clear sense in your heart and you just have a real peace about it. That is an area where the Lord is giving, it's like letting the peace rule in your heart. The Lord wants us to experience peace for the road. I want to share a song here. It's going to be up on the screen. And if you know it, you can feel free to sing along. Some of the words may be a little bit smaller, so but feel free to sing along. It's an old hymn called Wonderful Peace. And then after that song, we'll come back and finish off with a few other things. Okay, let's try something else. So today you may be needing the Lord's peace in a specific situation. If so, just I want to just pray for you. Anybody just, be saying, I need the Lord's peace about something. Anybody today? Yes. And likely most many of us are. So Lord, I just thank you for your peace that is possible in midst of difficult seasons in life. And Lord, I just pray for your peace just to fill each heart and soul here. You know some of the health struggles, you know some of the life challenges right now. They just need an assurance of your peace and that you would minister to them in a very real and tangible way. And Lord, I pray for those of family members that are dealing with just some turmoil and chaos and needing your peace. Lord, I pray that your peace would be realized in every one of our family members' lives. We pray for around our world and think of the many chaotic places. We think of places where there are refugees right now and refugee centers that are just overwhelmed, and those that are there as well as those that are trying to serve. Lord, we look to you for your peace. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Here's a concluding verse and a blessing for us here. It's from 2 Thessalonians 3, verse 16. May the Lord of peace himself give you peace always in every way. The Lord be with you all. In that part of the verse that's buried in the middle where I have highlighted, always in every way. Peace always in every way. It kind of sounds like peace for the road, peace for the journey. Always, in every way. May you have peace for the road. Let's conclude with one more song, and it is page number 33. It is Well With My Soul. Page 33.
Thank you.
Himself give you peace always in every way. The Lord